Welcome to Programming with Qt Widgets. I'm Jesper Pedersen from QTopia. In today's episode, we'll go a bit behind the scene and try and look at the macros involved in the signal slot mechanism. Before we get started, I'd like you to get some paper and pen because we're going to do a bit of quiz today. And I hope you have it now. Excellent. The first question in the quiz is, in pure C++, if you have an instance of a class, say foo, how do you ask that instance for its class name as a string? That is foo, F-O-O. How do you get back to that string? Question number two. When you're doing the old style signal slot mechanism of connecting the Qt four-way, are there any string matching happening at every signal emission? Question number three. When you emit a signal, is the event loop involved in the emission? Okay, let's get started. I'll get back to the answers throughout the episode. So what I'd like to do in this episode is to go a bit behind the scene and look at the, whatever they are, this the public slots, the signals, the Q underscore object, and figure out what all of these are. And at the same time, I'd also like to debug my way from a signal emission to a slot invocation to see what is going on there. And throughout all of this, we'll also end up in the mock file and see a bit what's going on there. I got an application for us for this. It's a super trivial application. So let me just show you more or less the entire application. I have here on my main a connection from an emitter, which is my emitter, into a receiver, which is my receiver over here, into the A slot. The my emitter class has two signals, and that's for us to see what is going on in the mock generated code. The signal here is being sent out from a method in here. And what you can see is that I'm connecting that whenever this, and by the way, I'm a push button here, whenever this push button is clicked, then the send signal should be invoked. And this is likely the only case in the whole universe where a signal to signal emission would make sense. I could have written connect this comma Q push button clicked comma this comma my emitter a signal, but I want to have something to break on down here so I can say this is the place where I emit the signal. Okay, back to our main. The other side of it was my receiver a slot, and my receiver a slot, I have a slot and another slot here just so that we can see what the mock generated file looked like again. And a slot is not very interesting on its own, but it gives me, as you can see already now, a place to put the breakpoint. But let's go get over here and look at the header file. In here, I have done it the Qt four-way, the way that is compatible with the past. And in here it says public slots, which makes me wonder, what is slots? Give me your best shot. Excellent. And if you have answered, let's just go and see what it is. And that's the cool thing about using Qt. It comes with the source code, so we can actually look at it here. So looking at slots, if I just press F2 on it, it'll go to the definition. Define slots to be Q underscore slots. Okay. That's not that interesting. Let's try and see what that does. Q underscore slots is defined to be Qt. Annotate access specifier Qt underscore slots. Let's try that one then. Define Qt access specifier to be nothing. So in the last 9 videos, I've told you about all those things that we put out for free. Newsletter, blog post, these videos, lots of software like Clacy and KD Toolbox and so on. Why are we doing that? Well, first of all, we need those things ourselves to do our work. And second, we want to share with the world what we can do. We believe that once you have seen the quality of the software that we develop, that you have the confidence that we can help you with your problems. I must have shown this like a million times in class by now. Every time it feels more or less the source code actually changes. So trust me, this was actually the first time that I saw the Qt access specifier and or Qt annotate access specifier. I was wondering to myself, what does that do? So I was looking in source code and I couldn't find anything. And then I did what is a super useful trick. I already have the Qt source code complete tree checked out so that actually can go to the source code and grab through the whole thing. And that's what you see here on the screen now. I grabbed using HE through the whole hierarchy of the Qt source to look at what is Qt annotate access specifier. And I saw that if not defined and define and Q slots and Q signals defined here, that's what I already seen now. But there is this one up here, clang code parser minus T Qt access specifier to be something. And that's why I test whether it's set or not down here. So whenever Qdoc, that's the documentation for Qt, whenever that is being compiled, then it's set on clang, it seems. It sets this Qt annotate access specifier to be whatever. But in any case, all these attributes, they boil down to, in the end result code, at least from execution, to nothing. So if we go back over here again, and just go back a bit, we started with public slots, and slots was just qslots, and qslots was just this Qt annotation specifier, something, something. So basically, slots is nothing. If you voted for slots being nothing, if that's on your piece of paper now, then give yourself 5 points. And that brings us back to why Q underscore slots, what's that about? And well, that is about the idea of that slots, S-L-O-T-S, is not a private word in C++. You could have in your own code, if you were doing something diagram where you can connect something, then you could have the word slots in there. And to avoid a collision, you can actually define this Qt no signal slot keywords. And if you define that one in your compilation setup, then slots will not be defined. And in those situations, you'll have to write Q underscore slots in there. And actually, if you're interested, maybe not right now, but once you're done with this episode here, go and check out Qt Widgets and More. In there, I have an episode where I talk to Giuseppe Angelo about reading the source code of Qt, and we do actually drop by some of these macros. Okay, that was slots. That just was nothing. Then we have signals here, a section in your C++ file, and remember the compilation of this. I simply compiled the CPP file that includes this header file. It's compiled without being pre-processed in any way, so this must be valid C++ code. What can signals possibly be? Write it down now, and let's go and see. So signals is, define signals to be, okay, Q signals. Define Q signals to be public, and then this annotation stuff again. So if you wrote public, then you get 5 points. If you wrote public Q signals, then you obviously already saw it when I did the grep before, so you only get 5 points still. But why public? Actually, in Qt 5, it was protected. Or was that Qt 4? No, that must have been Qt 4, because in Qt 5, the new signal slot mechanism got improved, and there it is. If it was protected, you couldn't from the outside get the address of the member member function, that's remember the signal slot mechanism is pointer to member function. You couldn't get that pointer if it was protected. Therefore, it needs to be public. But in the past, it was protected simply because it doesn't make much sense to get an instance of somebody else's object and emit a signal from that. Actually, let me elaborate a bit on that. Remember, we have, there we are, three access specifiers in C++, private, public, and protected. And I would argue that they forgot about the fourth access specifier, namely signals, which should have been in C++, if you ask me. Because if you look at the design patterns, for example, a lot of the design patterns is about how do you communicate state changes to your object to the rest of the world. And that is exactly what signals is. And that's why I believe to some degree that Qt is very successful, namely because it added that signals, which made a good separation between different objects in Qt. Now, if you could go from the outside and emit on behalf of some object its signals, that basically goes like this. Like, if I were an object, thank you very much for looking at me like that. If I were an object and whenever I had my birthday, I would emit my signal saying, I am now 28 years old. Yes, I'm not 28 years old, but that was somebody else that came and emitted my birthday change or my age change signal and told that I was 28 years old. And now people would behave to me as if I was 28 years old, which I unfortunately am no longer. And therefore, it would be violating the state that is called Jesper if his age was emitted by somebody else. So you should never, or only in very rare situation, go around and emit somebody else's signals. And that's why it was protected. And due to the pointer to member function, it became public. But just because it is, don't emit somebody else's signal. Oh, now I'm seriously confused. Not me, of course. I'm just assuming that you're saying that. Why are we adding public slots to our header files? And why are we writing signals colon to our header files if they are just being hashmark defined to be nothing again? Well, that's because that there are multiple entities reading your header files. Of course, a C++ compiler compiling your CPP files is reading the header files too, but so is mock. And whenever mock is reading it, it gets to a signal section. It'll take out its little handbook and it'll start making notes about which signals there are and which parameters they take and so on. And that is why we're doing that in the first place. In your source file, which mock is not reading, it's only a C++ compiler. You write emit a signal and the parameter list. Why? Or what does emit expand to? Okay, you wrote it down. Let's see what emit expands to. Emit, hashmark, define, emit, nothing. So if you wrote nothing, you get 5 points. If you wrote anything else, take 1 point just for the good spirit of playing along. But why am I writing emit then? Well, I could not write emit. It would be exactly the same. So please do not abuse what I teach you and stop writing emit. It is for the eyes of whoever is reading this source code. Emit is for your coworkers. When they read the source code, they read emit a signal and they know, okay, so this is a signal being emitted. And you can say, well, come on. My coworkers aren't that stupid that they don't know that a signal is a signal. Well, here's a more likely name for it, checked. That's the signal you have on checkbox. Does that actually set the check or what does it do? Your coworkers will ask themselves. But emit checked, they know, okay, so this is emitting the check state. And this leads us to the very last macro in here. Let's just jump right to it. We have it here, Q underscore objects. Get your pencil ready. Write down what you think it is. It's okay to pause me if it takes you a while to think about it. Okay, it expands to this code here. If you wrote that down, give yourself minus 200 points for cheating, unless you actually guessed it. No. And otherwise, what is going on here? Well, all this stuff here is going to end up in the header file for the class that you are defining. So I'm defining my emitter here, which is a subclass of Qt push button, and it will have all this code here. And first of all, do notice that it says public colon something, because it wants to make that into the public interface. And this is private colon something else. And the reason why I told you some episodes ago, always put Q underscore object at the very top, is because if you had put it, say, here, then you would be likely very confused about the fact that my emitter is now private. And why is it private? Well, because we end up in a private section here. So that's why it's public now. You'll notice a lot of other stuff in here, and a bunch of macros, and I'm not going to go into all the details of those, but there is one thing to notice, namely we have a static QMeter object, static meter object. And what is a static QMeter object? Well, that's an instance of a QMeter object that where you'll have one instance for all your classes of that particular class. Yes, that makes sense. And you can access that by meter object here and so on. So let's go and see what is actually inside a QMeter object. Ooh, didn't want to go there. Well, I did actually plan on pressing one instead. Of course, it's a public class, and there's some few interesting things to see in here. Wow, what a cliffhanger. QMeter object, does it get any better? Well, I'll continue talking about QMeter object tomorrow, and I'll answer the last few questions that we have outstanding, and we'll see a tool, super cool, the best tool ever for Qt development. That is all in the next episode. Until you get a chance to watch that episode, have a great time.